Hello, I'm Terry David Mulligan. This is the Mulligan Stew Podcast. If you subscribe on Spotify, Google Play, or Apple Podcasts, it will come to you directly each and every week. We're approaching episode 200, and I think next week we'll be able to tell you actually who that guest will be on episode 200. By the way, speaking of next week, the guest will be Kevin Moore. He's released his next album. It takes him back to his childhood home in Compton, and it's called Good to Be, and it may be his best ever. So that's saying something. He has a great career, but we're going to take him back and talk about how he got to that point and consider his thoughts on Black History Month. So, Keb Mo, next week on the Mulligan Stew Podcast. I had a chance to interview Paul Janeway not too long ago. He's two characters. He's Paul Janeway, the mild-mannered bank teller and preacher in training, who learned to sing in his church choir, listened to only gospel music and church radio, and tells us that the gateway drug to popular music for him was an early album from Tom Waits. So as I started at the beginning, he is two characters. He's Paul Janeway, but he's also St. Paul of St. Paul and the Broken Bones. That's a whole nother guy, a whole nother character. And that's the kind of guy he is. He's very engaging. Lead singer, co-founder of St. Paul and the Broken Bones, and they have released their fourth album, The Alien Coast. And it refers to the Gulf of Mexico and all of the states that border the Gulf of Mexico. And when the Spanish explorers first discovered that area, they called it the Alien Coast. One of the treats of doing this interview on Zoom is that we can record it on camera. You can see Paul Janeway at his very storytelling best. You can see Paul Janeway at his storytelling best if you go to our YouTube channel, Terry David Mulligan YouTube, and check us out at mulliganstew.ca. The tour dates are there. You'll find a video or two. So we know St. Paul and the Broken Bones as a sort of a soul gospel R&B group, like hard with horns and things and shades of Stax Volt and Motown and OK Records, but led by a guy who does look like a bank teller. But in fact, he sold kids' shoes and things, but a voice that just goes all the way from the Reverend Al Green to, say, Joe Cocker and beyond, like all sorts of shadings. And a band that pushes them. Now, what the interesting thing about this is this: if you've fallen in love with the first three albums, we're going to talk about whether you're interested in following the direction they're headed now, because someone likened it to St. Paul and the Broken Bones recording along with Pink Floyd. I don't quite buy that, but there's certainly different shadings now. They have turned a corner, and I'm kind of interested to know if you're going to follow along with them turning that corner. This is an engaging conversation. We're going to cover a lot of ground. I won't get too hung up on the lyrics from The Alien Coast, but there's Greek mythology referenced, and Spanish painter Bermeo and St. Michael triumphs over the devil. That painting is referenced. And just keep in mind, this is not just some upstart band. St. Paul and the Broken Bones opened for the Stones, did an NPR Tiny Desk performance, tours that brought them much acclaim and stardom. Lots of television appearances on Colbert's Late Show, Elton John's show, and CBS Saturday Morning. We have included tour dates on our website, mulligans2.ca, because they are going to hit the road big time. They're playing Toronto and Ottawa. No word yet on Vancouver, but I will prod him at the right moment. We're also going to play three tracks for you: The Last Dance, Minotaur, Love Letter from a Red Roof Inn. Enjoy. Here's a conversation with Paul Janeway, who is St. Paul of St. Paul and the Broken Bones. Enjoy. I'm Terry David Mulligan. This is the Mulligan Stew Podcast. And Paul Janeway has joined me, St. Paul and the Broken Bones, on the line. Where are you? Where have we found you?
In Birmingham, Alabama.
Is that a Baron's hat?
That absolutely
very nice,
is.
Very nice. You and I have been crossing paths most of my life, and certainly half of yours. But I'm in the process of moving, and I have a chance to listen in my car to music as I'm driving. It's a good thing to do. And I came across, well, this album in particular, the Oxford American, Southern, and it's all Alabamans making music. The one on the bottom was Sister Gertrude Morgan, Fred Lane, Dinah Washington. I mean, it's fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
How old were you when the music that was around you finally caught your attention? Do you remember?
I was probably in my late teens. You know what I mean? It's not something, you really, unless you, I guess, were educated about it. It just was kind of something that was around, right? You know, like you would see, you know, especially here in Birmingham, you would see things of Sun Ra and you know, then you'd have like Muscle Shoals and all of that. It would just kind of be around. And I don't think I really became aware of it until I was later as a teenager. Yeah.
Do you remember the experience of seeing your first live band and what came over you?
Well, it was a gospel group, if that counts.
Absolutely it does. Totally.
It was a gospel group. I was fascinated by it. I think you go through that experience and you see these people performing, and you know, they're doing harmonies and things like that, and I thought, man, that sounds amazing. Some folks on my mom's side of the family would travel the Southeast or sure. Alabama as a kind of a singing gospel group. So I don't know. I was definitely fascinated by it, but that's my first, like, and that was when I was young. That was my first kind of memory of seeing something like that.
I had an epiphany, and the British invasion came along, and I went, oh, what is this? What's going on? What is C.C. Rider, the Animal House of Rides? What is going on? You would have easily heard XCRB Del Rio, Texas. Did you hear Wolfman Jack? Did you hear an announcer that was bringing music to you, changing your life, even if you didn't know it?
You know, it's weird. I grew up very religious. So sure. The only station I was listening to was the local gospel Christian station. So I would say in a lot of ways, I'm a late bloomer. Okay. You know, when I got older, I was able to listen to music that wasn't church music. So sure. Now that was actually, bizarrely enough, the gateway drug to that was Tom Waits. I know it's interesting.
No, man.
So I don't know why that's the case. I don't know. You know, I guess I had read something or. You know, he reminded me when I heard him play, especially his early stuff. I actually really like his later stuff more, but he reminded me there was a woman in our church that would play the piano.
Yeah.
And she'd just play it, you know, they had similar styles of playing, honestly. And so anytime I hear some of that older Tom Waits songs, it puts me in like the sanctuary of the church I grew up in a bizarre way.
He did an appearance on a morning show that I was doing. We were so lucky to even have the guy come in at 8 o'clock in the morning. I don't know how that happened. But he played the chord of the song that he was about to do, the little arpeggio, took both of his hands, ran them through his hair just to get the hair out of his eyes. The note hung in the air, and he started in, and I thought, yes, that was my religious experience.
That's pretty amazing. That is pretty amazing.
How did you not get pulled into being a preacher that whole life?
Well, I think what happens, you know, when you're from rural Alabama, you know, when you start, your worldview kind of expands a little bit. I think that's really what started happening was I started kind of my ideological, you know, kind of, or my moral compass was kind of going, well, this doesn't feel right. If we're talking about loving everyone and those kinds of things, like I didn't feel like there were certain, you know, certain views that aligned with that. And so I was, it was really an internal struggle. And I just started to kind of fall away from it because I just kind of thought the aspects of love, that seemed like the most important aspect of all of it, was to love others. And I didn't feel like that was something that happens a lot. And so my worldview just kind of expanded, and I, you know, moved out of Chelsea, Alabama, moved to Birmingham, which is the big city
Sure.
in Alabama. And
Yeah.
I just think my worldview expanded, and I thought that's I'm not going to do something if I don't mean
You know, you could have been a great accountant. You know that.
it.
You could have been in the Hall of Fame. But no.
I was going to be a mediocre accountant. I can tell you that right now. It was one of those things. I was going to be a mediocre accountant. There's no doubt about that in my mind.
Then let me stop you there because I know that you've gone over those subjects time and time again. I just find it fascinating because I thought I was going to be a policeman. I ended up being an announcer and an interviewer. The defining moment when you realized your destiny, was it a quiet moment? Was it a loud moment? Do you remember?
It really was a realization. It wasn't like a dream come true. It was a
Okay.
realization. It was like, this is what I'm supposed to do. It was a number of things kind of piled on each other. But I remember actually there was a club here in Birmingham called Bottle Tree Cafe. And it was a 200 cap room.
Sure.
And I remember we sold that out one night, you know, early on. And I knew then, I was like, okay, there's this is a realization, like this is going to be something. Now it might be something for, you know, a year or two, and I kept thinking that, like, you know, this is gonna go away. But I was like, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. Like I've never felt that. I'd always struggled with other jobs. I'd worked all sorts of odd jobs, a bank teller, worked on a paving crew, worked, you know what I mean? Worked at a kid's shoe store. And for some reason, and like maybe this was arrogance, what I just like, I just thought, man, I don't fit here. I could never, you know, this never felt right.
So you were searching, searching, searching.
Exactly,
Oh.
searching. And then when that happened, when the music thing started kind of like going a little, I was like, oh, this is it. This is what I'm supposed to be doing.
Take us through the first. I want to play a couple of these tunes. Can you take us through the first couple of singles?
The first couple singles.
Yeah.
The Last Dance is the was the was the first single
Sure.
that we had
Right.
released. That one is it's kind of a the world is ending, so
Yes.
let's just dance through it.
Yeah.
It's kind of got like that disco, I would say, you know, some LCD sound system, Daft Punk kind of stuff to it. It's a really fun song. I had to, it's interesting. That was a demo that Jesse had, and I had to be like, hey, I really think we need to do this. Like,
Sure.
this one's something. And everyone kind of kept keeping it on the back burner. And I was like, no, we need to, this, there is something to this. We need to work this out. So eventually we did, and it ended up being the first single. So I was like, I'm right. I told you.
Knows we need it right now. She's feeling So, Paul, when you were uplifted by spiritual existence within the church, and when you were uplifted on a stage, singing, playing, having an audience, hang on what you were doing, did they get parallel? Did you find that same juice flowing in both lines of current?
Yes. I mean, I think there's definitely a spiritual aspect to what we do.
Hell,
I mean,
yes.
I don't think there's any, I think that's where you find, I mean, I just don't think, I think we all, whether, you know, whatever faith or, you know, whatever we believe,
sure,
that moment of, I mean, to me, it's a more open space when you're playing a concert and you're the conduit of something, a magical moment. And it doesn't happen every night, you know what I mean? But you have that moment, that electricity where you all can feel it. And you're like, it's not something, that's why like we're all like these virtual concerts that everyone was doing in 2020. Like it was a good thing, but it didn't work for you. No, I mean, it's just not there, you know, like it's a good thing. I mean, it's what we had to do, right?
Well, you can't stage dive.
It's hard. I mean, I could mess up my living room or something. Maybe that would.
Can you? And there's nobody there to catch you. Do you remember your experience at the Edmonton Folk Music Festival? Can you remember that gig? Outdoors. A slope. It was a ski slope in the winter, of course. And you went out and worked the slope.
We were in the show, and I told the monitor guys, like, we're going to see how far this mic can go.
Okay.
And he's like, okay. he's like, that's a pretty big deal. I'm like, I'm feeling it today. And so what's funny is I think I get about halfway up and then the mic starts cutting out.
Okay.
And I was like, okay, all right, I got to go back. That festival, that's a lot of fun. You know, I don't know if y'all know this. Our bass player is from Fernie, British Columbia.
Wow.
So he is a BC guy.
That didn't show up in the bio.
I know. Well, you know, he's very low key, which is great.
What's his name?
But Jesse Phillips.
Sure, of course.
But his mom is Irish and his dad is Kootenai. So down there. So he was around
at the beginning, was he not?
He's the reason this band exists.
Exactly.
So
that's astonishing.
It's a Canadian. So it's really funny. He's my best friend. He was super excited. You know, obviously anytime we get to play that part of the country, which is not, you know, it's a long way for us.
Sure.
He's always excited and family come and all that stuff.
Well, that's great news. That's a wonderful piece of news. It's important for me to know this, and I hope the audience will understand. The question is, we all have our voice, speaking, being whatever, but for singers, it's everything. How long did it take you to find what your voice was that you were going to run with? And said, this is me. This is exactly where I live.
I've always kind of sounded the way I've sounded. I think it was more of a stylistic thing. Okay. It was more, what style of music does my voice fit better?
Yeah.
Because when me and Jesse first started, like that's, we had our friendship and we were in a band and it was more of like a rock and roll thing. And my voice, I was always like, my voice can do that. I can do that, but I was like, man, I'm more of a bluesy kind of R&B soul kind of thing. And so it took us a while to go, okay, that style, you know, you had Muscle Shoals, but at the same time, you also had like Amy Winehouse and some of the Dat King stuff going on. And so I think once we started writing songs like that, I really did like focus in. And then what's funny is like, then I could expand to do other styles of music, but I had to get, you know, I could do it pretty well, but it took just figuring out what style was the right style.
I'm just watching you go through with St. Paul and the Broken Bones, the EP Greetings, Half the City. Oh man, well done. And then you started to expand. And so now we have Alien Coast. Mike, this is your fourth album. the side projects, but there's the fourth album, and it's important because you've stepped off expectations, and you've headed in a slightly different direction. Will they or will they not come with you on this journey? But you as a band, you as an artist and writer, had to take this step, right?
Right.
And what is that step?
I think that step is, I think when we first started, it was a very specific influence.
Sure.
And which is great. When you first start, I feel like maybe you kind of rely on your past a little bit. This record is the one where all the influences show up. Everything that we are into or that we like, they show up in this record.
Picasso?
Picasso. Everything kind of under the sun. This, right? I think it's important. I for me, artists that I admire, typically change, and they don't do the same record over and over.
Sure.
That's not something we're into. I'm not saying that we'll never make like a soul kind of record again. It's not what any of us are feeling at this point. It's been an evolution through each record, you know, and you got there. And so this one to me is kind of the full bloom. But I think it's important for artists to do that. I would much rather take a risk and fail than just do something that's, you know, kind of down the middle. Maybe that's the wrong philosophy, you know, maybe financially that's the wrong decision, but I think I don't think you stay happy. Honestly, I know bands that don't change, and I don't know one of them that's happy.
Well, I mean, I'll name names. I mean, look at the Beach Boys. They do that set and will do that set till they're done. No experimentation, no fooling around, and well done. I mean, they'll give you a show. If you came for a show, we'll give you a show. But you're doing a different thing entirely. You are speaking to people. You're asking for them to get involved and share some passion with you.
Yeah. I mean, I think when you do that, you have to change. Like, I have to do it makes me feel that passion. Because if I don't, it's not going to be very, you know, authentic or very real.
I think I saw you describe this as a fever dream. Can you explain that, this album and the songs?
So the record kind of works. Part of it comes from a night that I had an emergency appendectomy that almost killed my voice because of the tube, you know, they put down my throat. It was a very kind of scary thing. The appendectomy was fine, but the tube almost ended my career. But it was kind of from that, because I had to spend a night and I was on morphine and all that kind of stuff.
Sure.
And the idea is like this kind of fever dream, scary kind of nightmarish scenarios. And you have things like the Minotaur show up, and you have things like, Hunter and His Hounds, which has the story of Actaeon. And,
yeah.
And thing, there's all sorts of kind of odd characters that show up, and it's this nightmare. Bermejo and the Devil, which is a painting, Bermejo's St. Michael triumphs over the devil, like it has that in there. It's all these kind of cast of characters that go through of this kind of scary dream or whatever it is, psychedelic dream.
Bermejo?
Yeah, Bermejo, yep. He was a painter, a Spanish painter.
You'd see his exhibition in London.
Yeah. I sure did. It was I remember coming around a corner and seeing that specific painting and just being kind of awestruck.
Wow.
And so those are little flashbulb memories that you have. And that devil, for some reason that night, showed up and in the atmosphere, and I was like, thing's terrifying.
Smell him in the
Paul, I think people might want to know for St. Paul and the Broken Bones, Alien Coast, the fourth album, is about your home. It's about the Gulf of Mexico, right?
Well, so the title comes from, I was reading a book about the history of the Gulf of Mexico, yeah. And when the Spanish were coming into the area, you know, it borders Alabama, Mississippi, Florida, Louisiana, and Texas. And it was very foreign, you know, but something about the coast really was either, you know, it was really kind of mystified them. And so they called it the Alien Coast. And I put that, you know, I have little notes on my phone or a notepad and I'll write it down. Like, I love that. I just love that phrase. There's something about it that hits me. And then a couple years later we have this and I was like, this is it. This is perfect because it fits everything. It's about home. It's foreign. You know what I mean? It's a different record for us.
So for the title track, it may have been people around me, but did I hear bells or was I just crazy?
No, you heard bells.
Oh, good. Mission bells, right?
Yep.
I mean, they sounded, they had that tone.
Yeah, they sure do. Like that was our guitar player, Broen. he had this, that's from the demo. He sent that in. And that's when I was like, it was just kind of like, oh, this is cool.
Excellent. Hey, Paul, I saw a credit for Randall Turner, who's a hip hop artist locally. What did he bring to the mix?
Oh man, Randall was Randall works like a madman. Like I'm talking, like he's also like a tennis instructor and okay. Like has a job with like the state of Alabama. Like he's that guy. I was like, but he would come in after work and come in and like we were like we needed some like gritty like drum sounds and we really wanted that MPC, yeah. You know, like, and he was a master at it is a master at it. And so he would come in and we would just experiment. And like I would say most of the songs have a little bit of Randall in them, just from the experimentation. He's a good dude, man. He really is. I'm really glad we got to work with him, and he was open to the process. And then we had Love Letter from a Red Roof Inn,
exactly,
which is the last song on the record.
Yeah,
and there was a great debate of like, well, we should put that song earlier because it's, you know, it's a, and I was like, no, it makes sense for the record because that's when I've woken up, and it's time, you know what I mean? And it's like, but it's kind of a love song, but it has some of my favorite lyrics in it. I'm not the poet that you think I was, but I'll be your cliche. And then I say a very cliche thing in the chorus, which I'll be a fool for you, which if you've listened to any sort of soul song or something, there is always that in it.
Always
that's
that,
it.
Rick.
And I was like, man, I really like that line. You know what I mean? Like it was one of my, you know, you have those moments sometimes as a lyricist where you go, that's not bad. I like that. And that was one of them.
Well, you can't fool yourself. You know that. You know,
yeah.
You can't. Yeah. You know when crap's crap and when you hit the nail, right?
That is very true.
That's it. And you have to be true to that. You can't be, skating on thin ice. You have to actually, and because there's a democracy in every band, or there should be, you have to move forward as a group and, and you all have to believe in what you're doing. And it feels like you've achieved that. You've been exposed to the Stones live. You've done all the live television. You've opened for, right. And now you're your fourth album and you're stepping into it. You know, this whole idea of making money and being famous, you better get used to it.
Yeah, it's I definitely, we were talking about this, the band's been together now for a decade.
Sure.
Like this is a career now. Yeah. Like, oh, yeah. You don't think about that. You know what I mean? Like you just don't think in those terms.
Cuz it's a blur. But
it's a blur. Oh. Yeah. It's I mean, even in 2020 it was still like, you know, now granted me and my wife had our first child in September of 2020, so
congratulations.
Thank you. So that part really monopolize the time then. But even then, it was still, it's just, yeah, it's definitely a blur. It's pretty wild. So yeah, we are, it's a career now, which is really interesting and weird.
Weird in a good way?
I think so.
Okay.
I mean, my dad was not the most positive person in my life.
Wow.
And he always told me, if you don't expect anything, you won't be disappointed. And which is true. It's not a great way to live your life, but there's also kind of implemented that, like, the other shoe is going to drop. Like, if your good things are happening, bad things will come. And that is just not, I mean, we've had some tough times as a band, you know, just in personnel and things like that, but the success has been, you know, we've had steady, it's steady and good. And I just still to this day, I have to catch myself to be like, well, something bad's on the horizon, something bad's coming. And I'm like, you gotta get over
I
that,
mean,
Paul. Like,
and right in front of you is the example of Alabama Shakes. There's a
yeah.
band that they worked their asses off. They worked so hard to get to that point where they had fame and an audience, and then they all just spun out. Well, there were things to do,
Right.
things to get done, obviously.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think, you know, that does happen. I mean, for us, like, that's one of the, like, this, I can say with a lot of certainty that this band, we are in the, and I'm just saying on a personal level,
Sure.
on a musical level, this band is in an amazing place. I mean, like, it is, at this point, I could stay here all day. I do want to challenge myself a little bit and step out, you know what I mean, and maybe do some other things. But the band itself, it's a great thing. We got a great little collective right now that are doing a lot of fun things.
Do you see yourself doing any acting?
No.
Why do I?
No.
I've been doing it all. I've been acting all my life. I just see it in you. I know that there's a role for you there somewhere.
Well, I mean, I definitely, I'm open to any, at this point in my life,
Yeah.
like, I'm open to any. I think we are so fortunate in that, like I said, the band's very established. You know, obviously it could go away tomorrow, of
Sure.
course.
Yeah.
But as far as, you know, where the band's at, where we're doing, I'm kind of like, you know, we've been doing this a decade now, which is pretty wild to think. It's like, okay, I want to challenge myself. That would be a challenge, you know. I like that idea of challenging myself, because the band, we challenge ourselves, but we're so comfortable with each other now that there's not a lot of ego. So I can say something that 3 years ago would have hurt somebody's feelings, or someone could say something to me that would have hurt my feelings. And now it's like, no, our objective is to get the song to be where it needs to be, and that's it. It's not personal.
Do you get a sense of who the audience is? Has it changed? I mean, it evolves, obviously, and you.
It evolves. I will say this. It also depends on the part of the United States we're in. You
Sure.
know, it changes. Like, if you go to Canada, go to Europe or Australia or Japan, like, there are, I think, because what we do, it kind of hits in all sorts of spots. You don't know exactly who you're catching. But I will say the transition from, like, half the city to our third record, Young Sick Camellia, like, we had a song on our third record called Apollo.
Yeah.
And that song, there was a lot of young folks that for some reason kind of latched onto that song. So it was very interesting for us, which I'm, you know, happy about. You half the city, you got, I don't want to say older, but it, you know what I mean? Like, and now we're our like really, if you look at like our analytics and our numbers, the real sweet spot is like that 25 to 49. Like, that's our real sweet
Male,
spot.
female.
Honestly, it's split right down the middle, which is great.
Oh man, that's
Yeah.
fantastic. Well
Now.
done. And speaking of Canada, I see some. Well, first of all, you're planning a tour. Who knows if you can do it? You know, that's the crapshoot, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, what do you think? How do you how do how I mean,
I've
Canada, I'm
stopped.
not as
I've
familiar.
stopped thinking about it because it's driving me nuts.
We're cautiously optimistic. We know the States is gonna happen. Like, there's just, I am telling you, like, it is gonna happen.
Okay.
Toronto. I think we have Toronto and Ottawa.
Yeah, that's right. And then, but interestingly, you're in Seattle May 3rd. You're in Portland May the 5th. You know, Vancouver's just across the border, and the 4th is open, and it could be.
Trust me, we are getting to Vancouver. I promise you that. Vancouver is one of my, it's one of our favorite cities. Like, I love Vancouver. Jesse, obviously growing up in Fernie, like,
sure.
Vancouver was, you know, that was part, you know, he went there. We did one, I'll tell you something, one of the most beautiful places in Victoria.
Yeah.
Over there. Oh, man. That place.
I'm on that island. I'm just north of Victoria. Yeah, right now.
Oh, man. It wasn't the best time for the band, but on a personal level. But the shows, that's it. I love that place. I mean, Canada in general. I mean, now granted, I like it in the summer. I don't know if I'm a winter Canadian. No. I'll tell you that. But I do. Everybody's so kind. I mean, it's, I don't know. And plus, like I said, my best friend, the best man at my wedding, he is a Canadian. So, we're getting to Vancouver. I can't obviously announce anything yet because we have to wait. But we are getting to Vancouver.
Right. When you release a new album, do you give thought to, will they like it? Will they not? Will they follow us down this road? Or do you just do what you do and let the chips fall where they may?
I think if you get too preoccupied of what the audience will want, you're probably going to guess wrong.
Yep.
You might not. You might have your finger on the pulse of that. But what I have come to realize, happiness in touring, happiness in this, the first thing you need to make sure is that, do you like it?
Yep.
Is it something you enjoy? Because I can just say, yes, could we go out and do something that we think will have great success and the audience will love or whatever? Yeah, we can. But if we don't like it, we got to tour on it, and we're a touring entity, and we're going to play 150 shows a year.
Yeah.
And I could not imagine playing stuff I don't want to play.
Yeah.
Like that I don't enjoy. Like that, and that's going to come across.
What happens to you in those 10 steps from the side of the stage to the center mic? What happens in those 10 to 12 steps to you? Or have you already changed well before you ever hit the spotlight?
I don't have, like, the only thing this band does is right before we go on stage, we say Oasis Pizza, which is the first place that there's a story behind it, but that's part of our routine. But I'm not one of those people that, like, I have to get in the zone, you know? It is basically when you take those steps from curtain to mic, that's transformation time. Like that is no longer Paul.
Are you aware of the transformation, or are you somewhere else?
I think at this point, it just kind of happens. You know, I've done it so much that, like, there's only been a couple of shows where I was sitting side stage waiting to, you know, the band's playing and I'm good about the, and I was just like, man, I don't know. You know, I'm like, I remember one specifically, I don't want to say the town, but it wasn't a big town. And I remember being like, I don't know. And then the moment you make that walk to the mic, it's like, okay, there's Paul and then there's St. Paul.
Yeah.
And that's where that transformation to me kind of happens.
Does St. Paul do interviews?
Well, I would imagine there's it's really me just amplified to like 11, right? You know, it's my kind of therapy on stage. I it's weird. I think that there's always pieces of that in any, I mean, it's, I think I try to be as conversational in interviews as I can, but there is an aspect of it. It's like, it is a performance in a way, you know, like I don't want to come off as unlikable, you know. I guess I could.
Yeah, you've been really dodging my questions. That's
No, I try to be very honest. So I don't know.
I
don't know if they're one and two, you know, like, I don't know. That's a good question. That's a really good question. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure there's aspects of it for sure.
Take me back backstage for a second. What is the ritual you go through?
So before we get on stage, we all say Oasis Pizza. And Oasis Pizza.
Oh, okay.
It's a pizza, It was a pizza joint in Harrogate, Tennessee.
Okay.
And it's just a reminder of like, don't forget where you came from. Don't forget that you brought it that night. So you need to bring it tonight. And
Oasis
that's where
Pizza.
Oasis Pizza. So it was this pizza joint that was a convenience store. And I just was like, I'm gonna do whatever I can to get these people. There's like families eating pizza, and I'm on the table screaming at them while they're eating their pizza and just giving them trying to give them the show of their life, you
My
know. And
version of Oasis Pizza is the Worm Ranch in
the worm.
Walla Walla, Washington. It's a fishing store, but you can get really good cold wine there. And it's called the Worm Ranch because they sell worms. That to me is my that's
I love the Worm Ranch.
the
That
Worm
is
Ranch.
I guess is a great
I
name.
mean, you're drinking $50 wines in styrofoam. It's like you have to know what you want to do here. Are you a wine collector? Do you drink wine?
I've never drank alcohol ever in my life.
Get out.
No kidding. Never have.
Spliff? Spliffs? No
Nothing,
weed, no
man.
nothing.
Nothing. My wife, now my wife, you know, she likes her wine
Okay.
and some, you know, liquors and stuff, but it's weird. Like I grew up religious, right? And so when I was young, it was kind of a moral thing. Now it's just like, well, I haven't, so cool. I mean, the guys loved it because I got to be the designated driver. We were in the van. They were like,
Perfect.
we can rip and
Perfect.
roar.
Bring them along. Yes. Keep them in the band.
Exactly.
This tour coming up. I hope you get it done. I just hope you get it done because you can let those juices fly. I wrote down a note, a question here, and I've been debating whether to ask it. Your relationship with faith now, how is it?
It's not as bad as it was, you know, probably a decade
Okay.
ago. You know, I think for me, my wife is Episcopalian.
Sure.
And, you know, I grew up in like a very charismatic, you know, people speaking in tongues and the church went through a lot of transformations, but that was probably the most impactful. And the Episcopalian thing, it aligns a little bit more of my beliefs. And I got to be honest, I find a little peace in it. And so I don't, I should go more than I do. But I don't have the same venom
Okay.
that I think I did when I was, you know, in my early 20s.
Did you take a look at the Rock Hall of Fame nominees that just came out?
I haven't. Who all got nominated?
I don't have the list in front of me, I'm sorry, but they did a quick voting and Pat Benatar was at the top. And but I just keep thinking, can you see yourself there?
I don't know. I mean, it's weird. I did a panel one time with, I guess, the guy that runs the Rock and Roll Museum. And he always said, like, eventually everybody's going to be in there. Yeah, if you think about it, like, eventually everybody. So, like, these people are like, oh, I can't believe blah, blah, blah is not in there. And he's like, well, eventually everybody's going to be in there. So, I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if we're, I don't know. I don't know if we've had I don't know. I can tell you I don't think about that one. I
You
can
know who was at
confirm.
the bottom of that list? I think there were 16 names. Rage Against the Machine at the bottom of a list. Come on. Come
Yeah, no.
on.
Yeah,
What
Rage.
a band.
Yeah, that's an amazing band. I don't know. That is actually a bug. I've never seen them live, and I really want to see them live.
Stunning.
Yeah. I
Stunning.
mean, I really want to see
When
them
an
live.
audience moves as one, it's a powerful statement.
Yeah, it's I've that is a bucket list that I have not seen. I've gotten to see a lot of folks, but that is one I have not gotten to see.
Okay. I'll put the tour dates on the website and we'll sort of pencil in May 4th in Vancouver. If we can both get to May, that's our job, okay?
Hey, that's I am optimistic about the States, Canada. I don't know. I, you know, I'm like I'm pulling for it because I do like Toronto and Ottawa both. I'm excited about
I wish you many Oasis pizzas
it. Thank you.
and take care of yourself. Be a good dad,
Absolutely.
be a good performer. Don't ask too much of yourself that you can't comply. And whatever happens down the road, I hope you remember some of the blur, because it's going to be wild.
Yeah, well, thank you very much.
And congratulations on Alien Coast.
Well, thank you.
Well
thank
done,
you very
man.
Much.
Well done.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, man. Paul Janeway, St. Paul of St. Paul and the Broken Bones. The new album, the fourth one, is called The Alien Coast. They'll be touring shortly a lot and then heading for Europe. And they're playing two Canadian dates, Toronto and Ottawa. The details for the dates and the band can be found at mulliganstew.ca. Next week, our guest will be Keb Moe. And he brings with him beautiful new music from an album called Good to Be, and then in brackets, Home Again. That's the name of the single. He grew up in Compton, but his parents were from Texas and the Deep South. So it's a mix of the music that they brought, the music he heard in Compton and in Los Angeles. And we'll talk about the mix of music and how it came to be and how he became Keb Moe. It was the way that one of the guys described him on stage, and it stuck. it's a really good conversation because he is a good storyteller, as was Paul Janeway. So next week, Kev Mo brings new music and old stories. Please remember you can subscribe on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Play, and our YouTube channel. We'll see you next week. Be safe. Be kind. Thank you.